Good morning. How are you today? All right. Hey, just real quick. We haven't done anything like this in a long, long time. Tell me what the best thing happened to you this week was. I just want to hear four or five. The best thing that happened to you this week. You got up this morning. Okay. Yeah, I understand that. Yeah. Praise the Lord with your son in Idaho. What part of Idaho?
Mountain Home,
where's that near? That's one I haven't heard of.
Yes, by the Air Force Base.
Okay, all right. Ah, terrific. Oh, worship. All right. Good.
I got to take my 13-year-old granddaughter to Yosemite for the first time in her life, and she got to ride on a stagecoach.
All right, 13-year-old granddaughter to Yosemite for the first time. Awesome. I was 22 before I went to Yosemite. Baptized five at high school camp this week, man. That is awesome. That is terrific. They took 32 high school kids to camp this past week. All right, 32 kids. Got to baptize five. All right, anything else? Anything else? This really just was really good for you this week. Jerry?
We went to the fireworks and heard a musical group that was just
good. So 4th of July celebration was good for you.
Yes.
All right, outstanding. Yes. You got a new granddaughter. Who said that?
Great-granddaughter.
Your ninth one? As old as you are, it ought to be great. That is terrific. Woo! I just got one. Just one grandkid. I got a ways to go to catch up with you. All right. Your German daughter is here. Terrific. All right. Wonderful. That's exciting. That is great stuff. Shelly and I got to bring back a giant T-shirt for our grandson. First sports T-shirt that he'll have to wear. It'll tick his dad off because he's a Atlanta Braves fan, but that's okay. We'll get Bo started right. No, man. Dodger blue at our house. Sorry, Dodger fans. All right. I do have a Duke Snyder autograph in our house. Okay. So I have a little Dodger blue. Yeah. Anyway, moving right along. Welcome to New Hope Church today. It's great to have you in our fellowship. You honor us by being here this morning. And so thanks for coming. If you are a guest for the first time, there are some communication cards in the pew. I'd love for you to fill one out. Let us know that you were here today. We're not going to annoy you on the phone or pester you at your door, but through the mail, we'll send you some things that tell you what we believe and what we do around here and the ways you can be engaged if you are interested and answer hopefully most of the questions that you'd have about us. So we'd love for you to fill that out. Those cards are also for our regular church family and attenders. If you have prayer requests included in the bulletin or taken out of the bulletin, or you need to meet with somebody on the staff, information we need to know, please fill it out. It's always great to put your name on it, okay, so we can respond if necessary. All right, and I know, here's the deal. Usually when somebody has something critical to say, they don't put their name on it, okay? So let me just tell you, with all the kindness, let me tell you what I do with those. Okay, because I have no way to respond, all right? Often it's very short, it's very brief, it's to the point, and I don't know what to do with that, all right? So I love the dialogue. It doesn't make you a bad person if there's something that you want to share. And if we want to be able to address it, it's most beneficial if we're able to talk about it. So love to have your names on it so that we can follow up with those things, all right? Let me highlight a few announcements. And actually, let me do this a little bit differently. Pop? Dad, stand up. I got. Tomorrow he turns 91. 91. All right. Aaron, are you? Oh, Aaron, stand up. You have turned 50.
Yes, I have.
All right, half a century. Congratulations. I rarely look at Facebook, but it popped up today, and I had a few extra minutes, so I do know that a couple of our folks who get engaged in our Sunday school, Wynema has a birthday this weekend, and Heather, all right, has a birthday this weekend, so if you happen to see him over teaching Sunday school, school, Heather Lunsford. Wish them happy birthdays as well. The Wrights from our church, I acknowledged them last Sunday because I knew they would not be here. They're normally sitting right there on the end of that pew. And they're not sitting there today because they are celebrating their 70th anniversary. 70. That is a couple who did something right, okay? And they did it really good. And they are celebrating that in Bakersfield. Oh! It's because it's halfway between Fresno and San Diego, or kind of the best place for the families to meet. So they are gathering in Bakersfield for a little celebration today. And I don't see them in this service right now, but the bishops, all right, our youth pastor and his wife, they are celebrating their anniversary tomorrow, all right? So it's a double anniversary for Chris. Actually, it's the day they arrived here to go on staff. Was a year ago tomorrow. So if you see them before they leave, wish them a happy anniversary. I'm sure I probably missed a few folks, but it wasn't intentional, all right? So happy birthday or happy anniversary. Let me highlight a few announcements in the bulletin. There's lots of things going on in August, so I hope you take note of the schedule which is in there and begin to get a few of those things there. The office sent out this past week giving statements, kind of mid-year. How many of you got yours already? You know what that means? We have your right address. That's the reason they do that mid-year, is we are required by law at the end of the year. We have a limited amount of time to get those statements out to you for your tax purposes. And so the office determined a couple of years ago that if they did a mid-year statement, we can find out some of those addresses that are no longer correct and we didn't get updates. And if somebody may have entered something wrong under yours, please take a look at it. They can get those things corrected. So please call the office if there is a mistake or if you do not get yours in the next day or two, because we might have an address error or change that we need to address. This Tuesday, if you happen to be 55 or older, it is senior lunch here at the church. So you are welcome. You don't have to be retired to attend this. You just have to be 55 or older, all right? And come hang out, enjoy a wonderful meal. If you've never been, just show up. If you have been before, you know the routine. And if you've never been before, go to the dessert table first, because there won't be any left after you eat, okay? So just a little tip there. Thought I would let you know. All right, you and me forever, okay? It's not in your insert. We took it out, because I sent an email that said it's full, okay? Change of heart. Change of heart. Okay, because I had three or four emails, and I had three or four people in the 8 o'clock service say, oh, man, okay, we were going to come, and we didn't sign up. So here's the deal. The evolution, can I say that in church? The evolution of this process went kind of like this. Shelly saw this Bible study and said, Tim, I think you need to look at this. This is really, really good. And so I looked at it, and I said, you're right. Our small group is not meeting during the summer, so we have a Tuesday night free. So I said, okay, we're going to do it on Tuesday night during the summer. And I'd set a goal, if we've got 12 to 15 couples and or individuals, all right, who want to come to this, then we'll do this thing. So I was anticipating about 25 people. As of the end of third service last week, we already were up to 65. Then we had people call in, email in. I happened to call somebody about a completely different subject, and they said, oh, by the way, we're coming and we're bringing two couples with us. So right now we are at about 85. And that doesn't count the people today who said we really would like to have come. So here's the deal. We're going to open it up. Just come. And here's the way it's going to work differently than I anticipated. And this is where you have to trust God. Okay? My first thought was, no, we'll cut it off and we'll offer it again. All right? And people just have to wait. And then I thought, well, maybe that's not the best idea either. So we're not going to meet in the bridge, which is where we were going to meet. We're going to sit around tables, all right, meet in the bridge. We're going to meet in the sanctuary. So we can handle about 250 of y'all, all right? So if you did not sign up, you are still welcome to come, okay? Here's the deal. Since we pulled the sign-up sheet out and threw them away, I don't have a sign-up sheet to go around right now. So if you're going to attend, pull out one of the communication cards if you didn't sign up already, okay? Just so I can have it. I'm going to have to order some more books, okay? And I might be able to have them here by Tuesday night. Here's the other deal. You can download the book for free onto your Kindle, your iPhone, or your iPad. It's free. All you have to do is go to uforever.org. So write this down. I want to see some of you with pencils in your hand. Write this down. You can download this because you might not have the book. Go ahead and read the first two chapters, all right, if you get them. Youandmeforever.org. It's absolutely free. Okay? And here's what's cool about downloading it. Francis Chan and his wife have done some short little video vignettes that kind of highlight key points throughout the book. And on the one on your iPad or your iPhone, you just get to push the little arrow button and watch it right there while you're reading it. Now, if you have a hard copy book, you're not left out. You just have to have the youandmeforever.org, bring it up on your iPad, and while you're reading, then hit the button on your iPad, all right? And you can watch the video that way. So you don't miss out. It's just a little less convenient, okay? So this is a completely different Bible study than I've ever seen on marriage before. This has an eternal perspective, looking at life today from the eternal perspective. And I think it's going to be exceptional. A little extra caveat about this. Just so happens as we were driving Friday afternoon to San Francisco, which is where Francis Chan lives and ministers, Joe Avila, whose car we are in, he happens to be a good friend of Francis. I've met Francis twice. We've worked at two prison events together. But Joe calls him because we were going to go have breakfast at their place Saturday morning, but they're not open on Saturdays. And so Joe turned him over to me, and we chit-chatted about the Bible study that we're launching and how many people were going. And so we're working on a surprise during the Bible study. Can't tell you what that surprise is. But we're working on it. I can't guarantee it's going to happen, but we're working on a little surprise. It will be pretty, pretty cool. So this Bible study, whether you've been married 6 months or 60 years, I think you will find it helpful. Whether you are single but think someday you may be married, whether you're single and you're thinking that the person sitting next to you ought to get married to you, it would be appropriate to come to this Bible study. It is not a Bible study to fix your marriage, all right? Though if there are some struggles, I think you'll discover some fixes. This is very, very different, but I think it's going to be very, very enjoyable. So just satisfy my curiosity. If you didn't sign up last week and you didn't call or send me an email this week, but you think you're going to come Tuesday night, raise your hand. There's another dozen. Okay, good. Thank you very much. This gives me an idea of how many more books to order. And guys, if you weren't here last week to hear the pitch, there's nothing about how bad a listener you are in this study, okay? That's not even a subject in this study. So feel good about it, all right? Am I forgetting anything about that one? Okay, moving right along. Took care of that. Okay, jams, our kids, we got an event this coming Wednesday night. It's a water night here at the church. So if you have elementary age kids, sixth grade and down, they're having a special water night during the summer, and it's going to be this Wednesday night. Mark, when will tickets be available for the Grizzly game? Next week, you'll be able to see somebody out in the pavilion and pick up tickets for Christian Fellowship Night at the Grizzlies game. You can see Fawn Boss. Fawn, stand up so everybody knows who you are. All right, Fawn Boss, our women's ministry coordinator. You can see her for tickets for Giggles and Goodies coming up on August the 6th, a special night for women here at the church. I have not seen Mark Downs around here today. He might be resting. But if you happen to run into Mark, tell him congratulations. This will be his last week of singleness, and he will be getting married for the first time in his life this coming Saturday. All right. For those of you who don't know, Mark's a deacon here in our church. Mark was one who spent a little time at state expense, incarcerated. When he got out, he found Christ, and his life has never been the same, man. He's been in our church for the last several years. He's grown and matured. He's met a wonderful Christian lady, and they are getting married this Saturday here at the church. So if you run into him, tell him congratulations. We're very excited for him. It's great to have our Uganda folks back. All right, you recuperated? Got all your sleep caught up? All right, terrific. Speaking of Africa, we also have in 2 weeks coming to be with us is Mike Cousineau from 1040i. We'll be talking about the trip in February and how we can be involved with the village of Neonen for another year there. Some prayer requests and praise items. I found out this week that Carol Gill was diagnosed as cancer-free after multiple surgeries on her face, so we're grateful for that. Please be praying for Frank and Bobette Hicks. I spoke with Bobette this past week, and there is an official diagnosis now that Frank has Alzheimer's disease. So, and it's kind of progressed rather rapidly recently. So please be in prayer for Frank. Again, for those of you who don't know, Frank was a longtime member of our board here. And just a wonderful, sweet, sweet man and a wonderful leader. Went to prison every single week and taught a Bible study for about 12 years, I believe, if my memory is correct. So continue to pray for him. Marion Hicks is Linda Panos' dad, and as of Friday, thanks to the help of Amy Tobin and Heinz Hospice, got him under hospice care, and that is a benefit to them and of comfort, I think, to Marion as well. So be remembering to pray for them as they go through this. Charlene Dooms is Bernice Osborne, who's normally in this service, sitting right over there next to Dad, but she is up north out of Roseville with her daughter. Charlene started cancer treatment on Tuesday. She's getting 3 treatments a day of radiation, and this is going to go on, I think, for 6 weeks, okay, with off on the weekends. Very, very rigorous treatment. She has acute leukemia. Last word I got yesterday was that her attitude is absolutely terrific, but continue to pray for them. The Thiessen family. Many of you might remember Tim. He played baseball here in this area, coached as well. They're related to the Blankenships, Debbie and Sam, and they're going through some tough times in the death of their youngest son, Travis. And so please be remembered to pray for the Thiessen family. I got a Facebook from Jan Patton. Jan, are you in this service? She must be. I got one last week. She told me she was coming, but I got another one today saying you'll see me tomorrow. So that'll be exciting to have Jan back in church after she's recovered from the challenges that she's been through. And then Jordan Paulsgraf, one of our high school students, you know, she's had some problems with her back. She's had one surgical treatment already, and she's going to have another one tomorrow. So if you'd remember Jordan and that process tomorrow, they would appreciate it so very, very much. Those are the updates and the prayer requests that I have for you. Would you join with me as we pray? Our ushers will come and wait on us. Yes. Tim,
yeah.
You're going to Japan again?
I am. I'm leaving today.
You're leaving today? Oh. All right. You know why Tim goes to Japan?
Minister.
I've told you so. Yeah, that's right. He goes to ministry. And the guy he worked with is in heaven now.
Right.
So you're working with somebody new or somebody still connected to his ministry? All right, terrific. But and you've been doing this how many years?
15 years.
That's awesome. I cracked up when Tim told me this. So the reason that he's so successful in Japan is after the movie Sister Act. Isn't that the truth? Yeah. The Japanese people just love, all right, soul gospel music. And man, Tim does it well. So, all right. So how long will you be there this trip, Tim? For 2 weeks. All right, so we're going to be praying for you while you're there. All right, you got it. Ushers, would you come forward and wait on us as we have our tithes and offering today? Father, today we want to praise you and we want to bless you. It's what the psalmist David said was our privilege and our responsibility in Psalm 103, to praise you, O my soul, and to bless your holy name. And so, Father, I trust that that will be the decision of each of us and all of us as we corporately engage in this fellowship today. Father, thank you for the many rich blessings that you've given to each of us. But Father, I trust that as we think about the blessings you've given to us, we're not thinking about the house that we live in and the car that we drive and the new clothes that we bought this week. But Father, I hope, and we should never take those things for granted, because the scripture says every good and perfect gift comes from above. But Father, I pray we'll primarily think about the fact that our sins have been forgiven, that our failures have been transformed to victories, that, Father, you have a final answer that we may not see today that's far beyond anything that we could hope or think or ask, that, Father, you have helped us overcome the guilties for our foolish errors and our willful rebellion. You tell us there's now no condemnation. That should make us shout with joy that I'm not condemned anymore. Father, I want to say thank you for the peace that you give to us in the troubles of this life. And the Bible says you give us a quality of peace that nobody else is going to understand. And so, Father, I trust there'll be a lot of folks asking members of this congregation today, how come you're at such peace with all that's going on right now? And we can tell them it's because of Christ. Dear Father, your word tells us that you offer to us contentment in any and every situation of life, whether I've got a bunch or whether I don't have a thing. I've learned the secret of what it means to be content in this world. So, Father, there's so much to give you praise over. There's so many reasons for us to bless you. Enable us never, ever to forget. Father, we trust you with the needs we've talked about here already, those needs for treatment and surgery and recoveries and comfort. You know intimately about each and every one of them, far beyond us, and I hope you'll find us willing to be engaged in any way possible that you would direct us to be of help and hope to those who need it. For the privilege of giving and sharing, we say thanks today. Father, for Tim, grateful that he's a part of our team around here at New Hope, and Father, we're grateful that he is going to take New Hope, and I don't mean our church family, but I mean the hope of your grace to men and women in Japan, some of them never hearing the gospel before they hear Tim. Give him your, may Tim allow your best to be evident in his life. You've given him a talent and a gift that is a platform, but that platform is not for people to think Tim's a great singer, but it's a platform for them to discover that Tim loves a great God. And so give him the freedom to proclaim that through his life story so that lives can be changed. We thank you for this and so much more. In the awesome name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Hey, Milo, you come back here just a minute. Tim, don't leave, please. I'm going to do something really impromptu here. And I'm going to engage some of you for a minute, so bear with me, all right? I'm not going to ask anybody to say anything, but I'm going to ask a few folks to come up and join me for just a moment. I'm going to ask Errol and Andy, if you wouldn't mind, and be careful with your wife. She's got to climb two steps, and she's about to deliver a baby. So, Andy, would you come? I want Del and Reggie. Would you come up for just a minute? Where'd Mike Chen go? Oh, is it? Oh, there he is. Mike, would you and Susan come up just for a minute? Just for a minute. Lisa, is Lisa here? Lisa, you want to come and join Milo for just a minute? I know nobody knows this. Susan looks terrified. Yeah. Yeah. God, y'all look good. This has been a tough week for our nation. We are not a perfect country. We've overcome a lot of things in the past. We're facing I think another season in the history of this nation, much like we went through in the late 60s and the early 70s. For those of us old enough to remember, there were some very unpleasant days, and we've witnessed some of those unpleasant days this past week. What do you notice about this group up here? It's pretty diverse. Black, white, beige, beige.
That's what heaven's going to look like.
Black, yeah, yeah. Yeah, very, very white. I don't know what we call Chen, all right? And you know what? And some of these know each other, some don't know each other real well, but here's what I do know is we all love each other. And you know what binds us together? It's Christ, absolutely correct, it's Christ. We probably have different political bents on this stage, okay? I know we have different likes and dislikes about stuff in this world. But what binds us together is Jesus Christ. And we've got to figure out a way, church, that as the representatives of God's kingdom on the face of this earth, to take what binds us together here and take that out there. Otherwise, we will destroy ourselves as a nation at the very roots of the fabric. 8 o'clock service, we prayed for our nation. And I said, let's quit praying for leadership. Okay, let's start praying for citizenship. Okay, let's pray for the citizens of this nation to really own being a citizen of this nation. And what are little things that we can see and do and say that will make a difference? Because obviously what we say doesn't make a difference with the politicians. So let's do and say what God would like for us to do and say in our relationships in and out, so that this becomes not only what we can look forward to in heaven, but this becomes what we enjoy on earth. We're going to pray in just a moment, but yesterday, my wife was the instigator of this. We went to a Giants game with the Avalos, and we could have been home at about 6:45 after the game. Joe likes to eat, and so we stopped for barbecue in Oakland, okay? I like barbecue, but I think you've been to this barbecue place with Joe.
Okay.
I think you've been to this barbecue place with Joe. I'm just about to destroy the harmony we have on stage here. Okay, we went for sushi. This was going to be so spiritual, all right? My wife wants it 5 days a week, all right? So we're going to get home at a decent time even after we stop for barbecue. And then we stop in Lathrop. I didn't know there was anything in Lathrop to stop at, okay? I got to be honest. He takes us to the Ghirardelli outlet. Did you know there was a Ghirardelli outlet in Lathrop? I had no idea. Here's what Joe said. Joe said, you know, the barbecue has given me indigestion. I need something to settle it. And he wanted a chocolate sundae, all right? So we stop and I don't eat chocolate, okay? And I just don't. I don't like it. So Shelly and I split a butter pecan scoop, okay? It was really, really good. And we're sitting there at a table, and this place is packed. I mean, there's people just coming in all over the place, and we're sitting kind of in a corner booth, and right next to us is another table. It's a family. It looks like a grandmother and a granddad and a couple of grandkids. It was a mixed racial marriage. All right, big, tall, good-looking black guy, and he and his wife look like to be the grandparents and two grandkids. And they're just chit-chatting away, and they're having a good time. And Shelly whispers in my ear, and she says, would you look at that man? His smile just makes me want to smile more. I looked over at him, and big dimples, big, gigantic grin. And she said this to me like three times. I mean, you know, I was starting to get a little jealous here, you know. So anyway, I thought, okay, that's nice. Well, they got ready to get up and go. And there was this little nudge. Sometimes I ignore the nudges, and I shouldn't. But there was this little nudge that said, tell him. And I said, what? He said, tell him. So he was about to get up, and he hadn't stood up before. He's about to get up, and so I stood up to go over. And when he stood up, I wasn't sure it was a good idea. Okay? Oh, yeah, he's taller than Errol. All right. And he stood up, and I stuck my hand out, and I said, my name's Tim. We've never met. But I said, I just need to tell you what my wife told me. And I told him what Shelly had said to me. And he said, excuse me, but I need to sit down a minute. And he sat back down, and he got a little teary-eyed. And he said, I got to tell you, you've made my day. No, he said, you've made my week. And then his wife looked over at me and she says, it's those dimples that caused me to marry him. And we had a sweet moment. And here it is. Here is a mixed racial marriage. Here is Joe and Mary Avila. And here's a white Caucasian wife and an Okey boy with a little bit of Choctaw Indian blood in him. We're complete strangers. And yet, because of an act of kindness that was shared, a bridge was built. I may never see them ever again. Somehow, I think we'll get farther in this world if we learn how to share love and kindness than we will hate and ugliness. Somehow we got to figure that out, guys, because it is God's kingdom work in and through us, not our leaders, but in and through us that will make a difference. We need to pray for the city of Dallas, Texas. We need to pray for the families who have this feeling of injustice in their lives. And we need to learn to reach out to black or blue, to white or beige. We need to share this love of Christ. So we're going to join hands up here, and we're going to pray just for a moment. And we're just going to trust that what God does in us here, He will do through us in the rest of the world. Let's pray. Our Father, I love You so much. Thank You for the lessons You teach us in some of the most unusual places, like a chocolate outlet. And Father, thank You that Your grace speaks in and through each of us. And I pray that we'll have the courage to share that grace with others as those opportunities come up. Give us better ears to hear Your nudgings and to respond. Give us wisdom, Father, to look around us and see how we can make a difference in our neighborhood. Don't worry about the rest of the world. Right where You've put us, that is our place of responsibility in Your kingdom work. Father, and in this church, give us a greater vision for how You want to use us to make a difference in the place that You have put us. Thank You, Father. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And amen. Thank you guys for being a living illustration up here today. Turn, if you will, to Psalm 103, and I'm running way behind, and I have a 16-page sermon today. I'm not kidding, but I already found out at 8 o'clock we're just doing part of it, okay? So that's a good thing. I know I would save time if I didn't read the entire psalm, but I want to do it. So please turn there, and I want you to follow with me as we read these 22 verses. Psalm 103, and if you didn't have a Bible, look up at the screen. They've got one posted there for you. Praise the Lord, O my soul, and all my inmost being. King James, I believe, says, praise the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Have you ever sung that song? Did you realize you were singing Scripture at the moment that you were singing that song? It comes from right here. Praise His holy name. Praise the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all His benefits. In the Old King James, it starts out, who forgives all my sins? In the NIV, it says He. So I want to combine those two. He who forgives all my sins, and He who heals all my diseases. He who redeems my life from the pit, and He who crowns me with love and compassion. He who satisfies my desires with good things, so that my youth is renewed like the eagles. The Lord works righteousness and justice for all the oppressed. He made known His ways to Moses, His deeds to the people of Israel. The Lord is compassionate and gracious. He is slow to anger. He's abounding in love. Aren't you glad for that? I'm so glad He's slow to get mad at me. And I'm glad He rushes to me with love. Have you ever known people who were the opposite? They were abounding in anger and they were slow to love. The only antidote for them is Christ. As we keep reading through this, I want you to notice that in this chapter, this is both a personal and a national challenge. Part of these verses apply to us very, very personally, verses 1 through 5. Several of the verses in the middle talk about us together on a bigger plane, the nation of Israel as a whole. We can apply that to America as a whole, and then it wraps up on a personal basis again. He will not always accuse, nor will He harbor His anger forever. I love this next verse. He does not treat us as our sins deserve, or repay us according to our iniquities. We sing a song that illustrates that verse. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. God's grace does not give me what I deserve. He gives me what I need. For as high as the heavens are above the earth. How high is that? I got news for you. I haven't seen it all. I've never looked through a Hubble telescope. But as far as you can see, it still goes. So as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is His love for those who fear Him, who respect Him. Verse 12, as far as the east is from the west, so far has He removed our transgressions from us. It was only a couple of years ago, and I think I shared it with those of you here that day. That verse took on more powerful meaning when I realized God was very intentional when He put upon the heart of David to write. How many directions do we have? Four. We got east and west, and we got north and south. And I don't know about you, I never gave it any thought. I just thought you could pick any two. And you can't. God in His wisdom. I don't know if David understood this, but God in His wisdom through His Spirit as He moved upon David's heart says, no, I can't use north and south. Won't work. You know why? Because when I get to the North Pole, guess what I meet? I meet the south. I'm then going to go south. I can only go so far north, and then I have to go south. That's west, and that's east. That's west, that's east. You get the picture? I never get away. Wherever I go, east and west, it's still they never meet. They never meet. That's how far God puts your screw-ups and mine in His memory. Never remembers them again. As a father has compassion on his children, so the Lord has compassion on those who fear Him. For He knows how we are formed. He remembers that we are dust. As for man, his days are like grass. He flourishes like a flower of the field. The wind blows over it and it is gone. And its place remembers it no more. From everlasting to everlasting, the Lord's love is with those who fear Him, and His righteousness with their children's children. You see, how you choose to live today makes a difference on the next generation. Those great-grandkids, you make a difference in them. You make a difference. With those who keep His covenant and remember to, read that word out loud, obey His precepts. See, there's conditions to this. The Lord has established His throne in heaven, and His kingdom rules over all. Praise the Lord, you His angels. And please let me stop right there. He's not talking about you now. David isn't talking about you. Okay, and I've made this correction not too long ago. I want to make it again because I still hear it a lot. You are not an angel, and when you die, you do not become an angel. The angels were not made in the image of God. You and I were. When we die, we don't become a lesser image as an angel. And I hear people say, oh, now I've got another angel in heaven looking after me. And I understand the sentiment. But it's not good theology. It's not accurate. You become a perfected child of God. Yes, we got somebody else looking over us and encouraging us. That's what the Hebrew Hall of Fame of Faith, go to Hebrews chapter 12. Now there's this banister in heaven and we got this great cloud of witnesses cheering us on. But my mama's no angel. My mama today is a complete child of God in all perfection as God wants her to be. Far better than any angel. What David is saying is, even the angels praise God. You mighty ones who do His bidding, who what? Obey His word. Praise the Lord, all His heavenly hosts. You His servants who do His will. Praise the Lord, all His works, everywhere in His dominion. And the last line of this chapter says what? Read it out loud. Praise the Lord, O my soul. Just quickly, look over at the very next verse, Psalm 104. What does it say? Praise the Lord, O my soul. In my Bible, I have to turn a page to get to the last verse of 104. What does it say? Praise the Lord, O my soul. Chapter 4 begins and ends the same way chapter 103 begins and ends. Somebody said that this is the duet of the Psalms, that together they form a pair of praise songs. As Derek Kidner, an Old Testament theologian, said, in the galaxy of the Psalms, these are the twin stars of the greatest magnitude. Someone else said that Psalm 103 is one of the finest blossoms on the tree of biblical faith. For you and me, what Psalm 103 is it is a key. It is a key to unlocking the right attitudes and the right actions of worship. My prayer for us today and next week is that this passage will renew our minds and kindle afresh this idea of intimate worship personally and intimate worship corporately to our Heavenly Father. So the question I want to thrust out to us today is, how do we honor God in our worship? From Psalm 103, David provides us five critical steps in building a foundation to honor rather than dishonor God as we worship. Let me give you those five things quickly. I'm only going to get to one of them today, and we'll pick up from there next week. But here's the five things this chapter gives to us about worship. It tells us, number one, commence worship by blessing the Father. Start worship by blessing God. That's where it starts. Shouldn't start anywhere else. Needs to start with our attention on Him. This is an aspect of personal praise. Number two, cease from forgetting the Father's benefits. This is personal as well. Verse 2, don't forget the benefits of God. I remember the first time Major Thomas preached to us here on one night, and he said, God, help us to remember not to forget. And that's the same thing David is telling us here. Let's cease from forgetting. Let's stop forgetting these benefits that God has given to us. Number three, we move more to a national level now. It's verses 6 through 12. We need to comprehend the limits of the Father's anger. God gets mad. Okay? He gets mad. The Bible tells us anger is not a bad emotion. It can be, but it says, be angry and sin not. And there are times that God gets mad. My dad, as patient as he is, can sometimes get mad. Those of you who know my mother, she was the talker in the family. Oh, did she love to talk. My mother was the more aggressive one, all right? And we didn't see it often, but my sister and I knew when my dad's face turned white and his lips went thin, Mom knew it was time to be quiet. Okay? The father of the house had had enough. Do you and I realize that sometimes God has enough of us? That's why I'm glad that that passage earlier said that He is slow to anger and He abounds in love, because sometimes we try His patience. Number four, consider the Father's compassion. This is a national thing as well, all right, in verses 13 through 18. And then last of all, it comes back to not only personal, but universal. Continue to worship by obeying God's word. These are the five critical steps in building a foundation of genuine worship that honors God. Let's jump in at the first one. Commence worship by blessing the Father. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless His holy name. This psalm begins with that most amazing word, bless. I'm one who thinks you ought to write and bleed all over your Bible. So circle the word bless every time it's mentioned in this chapter. I believe it's used seven times. You will find it in verse 1 and verse 2 and verse 20 and verse 21 and verse 22. And it's used twice in a couple of those verses. Every use of the word bless in this chapter, except for one, six of the seven times the word bless is used, it is a command. We talked a little bit about this week in Psalm 100. This is an imperative tense. This is an act of our will. Worship cannot begin till you and I, by the act of our will, choose to take action to worship. This is not passive, this is active. How many of you, when your alarm went off this morning, you thought very seriously about ignoring it? I got to be honest, I did. Okay? Joe Avila got me home at 10 o'clock last night. I was up at 4:30. He's coming to the 10:45 service. I'm throwing that sucker under the bus, man, today, all right? There was a brief moment. There's a brief moment when that alarm went off that said, oh, man. God, don't you have somebody else who could preach today? There was an act of the will that had to respond. Every single one of you made an act of the will decision just to be here today. Now, once you got here, you still have to engage your will to participate in worship. Because you can sit on that pew and you can be annoyed about the person who was sitting in your regular spot. And don't tell me it doesn't happen, okay? Because I know it does. You can be annoyed about the song that Tim chose to sing today or how loud he was. You can be annoyed because I took a lot of time in announcements. You can be frustrated about a lot of things as you sit on that pew today. So just the fact that you engaged your will to be present here today doesn't mean you have yet engaged in worship. Once you are here, then right attitude and right action married together is what gives us a worship that honors God. So you must get to a place to where your circumstances do not dictate your expression of worship, but it is the character of God that drives you into the heart of worship. Bless. Act of the will, the scripture says, bless the Lord. It's tough. I struggled with this for a long, long time. God, who has everything, wants me, who has nothing of worth, to bless Him. How in the world do we do that? It's not because God has a bad ego. It's not because God has a poor self-image that He wants us to bless Him. But He knows that until we understand who God is for who He is, we will never become what God desires for us to be. You understand that? Till we really understand who God is for who He is, we will never, ever be encouraged to become all that God desires for us to be, which is a reflection of His image in His world. And so, how do we bless Him? Tim, you answered it in worship this morning. What does this mean? Surrender. We bless Him and we come to that point of worship that we surrender all, even our embarrassment. I know it's hard for us to say, and people don't have to raise their hands, but just try it one time. You don't have to. I don't do it all. You don't have to keep it up forever, and particularly if you didn't spray Right Guard on. Don't keep it up forever. Okay? But we tend to think, what's so-and-so going to think? This is worship about Him. It's what do we think of Him, not what do others think of us. What does this word blessing mean? There's three layers to this word bless. First, it means to praise and acknowledge God for His character, His actions, and His truth. Second, it means to adore, to be affectionate, to be in love. And third, it means to exalt, to yield in submission to Him. So how do we bless the Lord? By praising, adoring, and exalting. Not only is worship an act of our will, but engages our complete being. David writes, O my soul and all that is within me. Your soul is your true person, your mind, emotion, and will, and all that's in you. Deuteronomy 6:5 says it best, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. God honoring worship is not to be compartmentalized. We don't come to worship knowing that there are areas of our life that are not in submission to Him. This is going to be a graphic and nasty way to say it. But sometimes until we understand how nasty sin is, we never deal with it. Till I came to understand that he who knew no sin became sin. What's his name? The famous actor who did a movie on Easter. Till Mel Gibson did his movie, that I could visualize how ugly crucifixion was, and I saw what my sin did to Christ. Until visually I got that in my head, I didn't fully appreciate all that Christ had done for me. Most of us who are sitting here today, I know most of you are Christians. But sometimes you and I allow pus pockets of sin and rebellion to be hidden in our hearts, in our lives, things that we bury it in a closet and we cover it up and it festers and it gets worse. The scripture says we got to give this all to Him. Why? Because not only is the word blessed repeated here, but the word holy. It says we are to worship the holy God. In the Old Testament, Isaiah 6:3, Isaiah writes, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts, and the whole earth is full of His glory." And the New Testament ends in the book of Revelation with four living creatures, each of them with six wings, full of eyes all around, and day and night they never cease to say, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was, who is, and who is to come." His holy name captures the idea that He is awesomely different from anything and anyone else. So do you have a vision of God like David did? For there is no greater act and no greater expression when we believers commence worship by blessing the Father, for He is the only object of our worship. Did you notice the psalmist is not mentioning his wants or his needs anywhere in this chapter? If your prayer time begins by asking God to bless you, may I make a suggestion? Don't let that ship sail again. Flip this thing around, and you began your time of prayer by blessing God. So how do we do this? Verse 2 says, "Cease from forgetting the Father's benefits." Forget not all His benefits. What are those benefits? He forgives all of our iniquity. He heals all of our diseases. He redeems our life from the pit. He crowns us with steadfast love. He satisfies us with good so that our youth is renewed like eagles. Wayland Prendergast was 37. He lived in Tampa, Florida. He committed a spur-of-the-moment robbery. He hadn't premeditated this. He did this on his way home from a late night drinking session. He was sauced. He was very drunk. Mr. Prendergast forced his way into a house through an open window that was upstairs. He filled a suitcase with cash and valuables before setting the living room on fire to cover up his tracks. He then escaped through the back door and he made his way towards his house, chuckling all the way. But as he turned the corner and got onto the street, the main street to his house, he noticed that there were three fire engines outside his house. He did not realize in his drunken state that he had in fact gone in the back door and burglarized and ignited his own home. His comment was, "I had no idea I had so many valuable possessions." And I wonder about us. Do we understand all the benefits that we have in this relationship with God? Do you praise the Lord and not forget His benefits? I think you would agree with me that in the busyness of life and the many blessings of life, we tend to forget how gracious God is for us. All of us fall into a season of forgetfulness. The first benefit, this is where I'm going to wrap it up. The first benefit is found in verse 3, who forgives all of our iniquity. That word iniquity is another word for sin. It's another word for transgression. It's another word for independence from God. And without forgiveness from God, our lives will be crushed. So when the psalmist recalls God's forgiveness, it's no mere whisper of a fading memory of forgiveness, but it is a shout in his soul that says, "I am a forgiven sinner who's now a child of God." Philip Yancey tells the story in one of his books of a prodigal daughter who grows up in Traverse City, Michigan, disgusted with her old-fashioned parents who overreact to her nose ring, the music she listens to, the length of her skirts, and so she runs away. She ends up in Detroit where she meets a man who drives the biggest, fanciest car she's ever seen in her life. The man with the big car, she calls him Boss. He recognizes that since she's underage, men would pay a premium for her, so she goes to work for him. Things are good for a while. Life is grand. Then she gets sick for a few days, and it amazes her how quickly the boss turns mean. Before she knows it, she's out on the street without a penny to her name. She still turns a couple of tricks a night, and that just feeds her drug habit that she started. One night, while sleeping on the metal grates of the city, she began to feel less like a woman of the world and more like a little girl. She begins to whimper, "God, why did I leave? My God back home eats better than I do." She knows more than anything in the world that she wants to go home again. Three state calls from home get three straight connections with the answering machine. Finally, she leaves a message. "Mom, Dad, it's me. I was wondering about coming home again. I'm catching a bus up your way, and it'll get there about midnight tomorrow. If you're not there, I understand." During the 7-hour bus ride, she prepares a speech for her dad, and when the bus comes to stop in Traverse City Station, the driver announces, "This is a 15-minute stop. 15 minutes to decide the fate of her life." She walks into the terminal not knowing what to expect, but not one of the thousand scenes that she played out in her mind prepares her for what she sees. There in that bus terminal in Michigan stands a group of about 40 people. They are her brothers and her sisters and their spouses and great aunts and uncles and cousins and a grandmother and a great grandmother to boot. They're all wearing goofy party hats and they're blowing noisemakers. And taped across the wall of the terminal is a banner that reads, "Welcome home!" Out of the crowd of well-wishers breaks her dad. She stares out through the tears that are quivering in her eyes, and she begins her memorized speech, and her dad interrupts her, and he says, "Hush, child. We got no time for that now. No time for apologies. We're going to be late. There's a big party waiting for you at home." Her story could well be our story, except our sin might be different from hers. Unlike her parents, God does want our confession. God wants to hear our repentance. And this story reminds us of another story in Luke where a son gets up from the pig pen and he goes to his father's house. And the scripture says, "But while he was a long way off, his father saw him filled with compassion. He ran to him. He threw his arms around him and he kissed him. And the son said to the father, 'Father, I have sinned against you and against heaven. I am not worthy to be called your son.' But here is this God who is slow to anger, who abounds in love. And he said, 'Bring me a robe, bring me a ring, bring me shoes, and kill that fatted calf. We got a party to do tonight.'" Thank God for his grace in Christ who enables us to be forgiven. Forget not your forgiveness in Christ and praise him every day. So how do we keep afresh in our lives the reality of God's great forgiveness? Hate your sin. Hate your sin. That pus pocket I talked about a minute ago, it sounds so gross. Don't cover it up with makeup anymore. Don't hide it in the closet and throw away the key. Dig into it. See it for what it is and lay it out there and hate it. I had a guy this week call me and say, "Tim, I got to come clean." He didn't live here. Known him for years. He said, I struggle with porn. Would have never expected it. And he said, "I've covered it up too long. I haven't admitted it to anybody. And I hate it." You got prejudice in your life, you need to hate it. You got anger in your life that's causing you to treat others badly and ignore God, you need to hate it. You're harboring ill will against a family member, a grudge, you got to hate it. Till we hate it, we won't confess it. Till we hate it, we won't deal with it. Once we hate it, then we'll confess and repent, and then we get to receive His forgiveness. Then we can pursue righteousness and be holy. I got news for you, folks. If part of the reason some of y'all are wanting to come to this marriage Bible study is because there's sin in your life, this Bible study ain't going to fix that. You can come 7 weeks to a Bible study. And I'm not picking on anybody that I know of. If you feel picked on, get mad at God. Bible study will not fix your life until you confess your sin. Bible study grows your life. It doesn't fix your life. And so I'm going to ask you to ask God to shine brightly His light of truth into your life and say, God, show me what sin You want to deal with in my life. And confess it. Confess it. Not to me, not to anybody else, but confess it to Him. And start towards righteousness and holiness with a clean life. Let's pray. Father, one of your writers said, "Oh, wretched man that I am. As long as I keep thinking I'm a pretty good guy and You're blessed to have me, I'll stay stunted in my growth." But Father, when we give You the freedom to expose to us those things that do not reflect Your DNA, Your character in our lives, love, joy, peace, goodness, gentleness, kindness, that's You and me. It's not You and me, it is You in me. And whatever gets in the way of the You in me to being seen through me is sin. And so, Father, I pray that You'll bring Your Windex and a rubbing rag and You'll clean off all the clutter that's in the way and help me see those areas of my life that You want to deal with. For those that are giving You freedom right this very moment to do just that. This is not an exercise to make us feel bad. This is an exercise to bring us to freedom. This is an exercise to bring us to celebrate. This is an exercise to bring us to full scope worship. No reservations. And You say You will cast our sins as far as the east is from the west. Thank You. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. God bless you. Hurry up and get out of here. Next service wants to get in.